York hardcore. One of the most beautiful and important things ever to come out of my hometown of New York City. Big part of my upbringing, big part of the indigenous musical landscape. And, you know, I've been living in LA for the past 3 years, and dude, I miss New York. It's like a wound, man. It's like a wound. I will say, when I was a kid, I was a little more of a metal kid. And so I wasn't like a dyed-in-the-wool hardcore kid, like in the sense of being in the pit every night in these shows and, like, you know, knowing everyone in the scene. Wasn't like that. But I played in two different bands that definitely had a New York hardcore influence. We're going to start this video by talking about how I got into New York hardcore, so we'll start with the 90s, then we're going to jump back to the beginning of the scene in the early 80s, and we'll go chronologically through in a more like historical way. I'm going to be thorough, but I'm not going to be even-handed or objective. You know, this is definitely going to be in my eyes. That's a DC hardcore reference, technically. I actually recently did a long live stream with Danny Diablo, aka Lord Ezek. If anyone wants to check that out, the link is in the description below. And before we really start, I want to give a shout out to Max Bernstein, who I grew up with and who got me into all this stuff, and Paul Delaney, a newer friend, who has, you know, sort of coached me a little bit on filling in the gaps here. When it comes to something as deep and rich as New York hardcore, everyone's got a million different opinions. So if anyone wants to weigh in, tell me how I fucked up, tell me stuff I missed, please go at it in the comments. I can take it. So the first hardcore I ever heard was Minor Threat, so not New York hardcore. And so that was my understanding of what hardcore meant. Super fast, shouting, extra intense version of punk, basically. Technically, the first New York hardcore I heard was Biohazard, and it just didn't really even register for me. Later, I realized that Biohazard are awesome, but at first it didn't really take. So the first time I really listened to some New York hardcore, it was Sick of It All. Now, Sick of It All are still now my favorite New York hardcore band, and it's possible that that's because they were the first one I ever heard. Who knows? But they really are a perfect starting point, not just for me, but historically, because they really represent this pivot point in the middle of the evolution between the old school and more new school elements. And I remember when I first heard it, I was like, okay, this is way different than, I don't get how this is hardcore the same way Minor Threat is, because there's like these fast punk parts, but then there was this metal influence, and it wasn't just metal, it was like this sort of groovy, grooving, bouncing, almost like funky a little bit, rhythmic feel to it, which absolutely gripped me right off the bat, but it was like different. So I first heard Sick of It All right before going to see them live, because me and my friends were going to see Helmet, and this band called Sick of It All was opening. I was like, what's up with this? My friend had the CD of Scratch the Surface, which had just come out, and he played some of it before me before he left, and I was like, this is awesome. I can't wait to see this. So we go to the show. Sick of It All opens, and they just melt my face. Unbelievable. I'd never seen any band be this intense before. It was just such a different experience, not just musically, but the pit. I had never seen people slam dancing and moshing for real. The other shows I had seen before that were Slayer, Dinosaur Jr., and Nirvana. That's a pretty cool first three shows, right? But at those shows, though, they had a pit, but it was like crowd surfing, right? But at this, it wasn't just crowd surfing. There was like a pit of, you know, dance moves, slam dancing, all right? Very different thing. And something that was really deep about it to me is watching the music and watching the pit, the tempo changes, the way the songs were pushing and pulling with the slower parts, the breakdown parts. When things slow down and there gets to be that more groovy, rhythmic feel, people just go off. The slam dancing and the moshing, it wasn't just people chaotically doing whatever. You could see that people knew how to do certain moves And there was a way of doing it. There was some kind of understanding of how they're gonna behave in the pit. Another thing I remember that I loved was this whole crew of guys on the side of the stage in the back, like, you know, in the, waiting in the wings, were like, but you could see them on stage. And like, they were all just doing on certain songs, doing the like, oi, oi, oi. You know, back in gang vocals, and like, I didn't know what oi was or meant. I later got filled in, like, oh, it's just, you know, this New York hardcore takes inspiration from British oi and like street punk and stuff, but I didn't know that. I just saw these guys chanting oi, right? There was just something special about like a crew up there. I felt like I was being like in on something. Like, I remember later listening to those same songs on the record, and they didn't have the oi chanting. So I was just like, oh damn, like they only do that at the shows. And so I felt like I had like really seen something special that you had to know about. And then Helmet played and they were amazing. I knew all the songs. It was great. But the way the crowd was just reacting to it, it just wasn't as intense, and it didn't have the same vibe at all as Sick of It All set did. And it's like, looking back, I kind of realized that it's like Helmet had their fans, but Sick of It All had their people. You know what I mean? It's different. I felt like I wasn't just seeing music, I was seeing a culture. There's this psychologist named Akeen Marino, who my girlfriend studied with a little bit. And Akeen Marino defines culture as, quote unquote, how we do things around here. And I just thought that's such a deep way of describing what culture is. I feel like that's what I saw in that Sick of It All set, how we do things around here. Everyone in Sick of It All are amazing musicians. I love the singer, Lou Collar, man. He's just the incredible frontman, just acrobatic, jumping all over the place, but not forcing it. He's like tough, but without being like a thug. He's skinny dude. You know, I like to see ectomorph representation on stage. And I love that his name was Lou Collar, because it's like one letter off from like blue collar. And I remember when I heard that, I was like, man, like, either that's an awesome stage name, or like, that dude is so real that his name is like his socioeconomic class. Like, that's real, right? The Sick of It All drummer, Armand Majidi, is such a ripper, one of the sickest hardcore drummers of all time. And so when he plays those fast punk beats, it's not like that sloppy, you know, trying to keep up scrappy punk sound. He's like laying it down. Part of the metal element of it was just how tight the musicianship was, and that was different from that older hardcore sound. The most highly regarded classic Sick of It All record is Blood, Sweat, and No Tears from 1989. No tears for my eyes. Classic, unstoppable. But actually, my favorite is probably Scratch the Surface. Again, maybe it's because it's the first one I heard. So New York hardcore is in some ways very similar to the other hardcore scenes going on in America at the time. But in other ways, it's unique. Something that's similar is that it's really moving past the nihilism of punk to something that's searching for higher values, higher truths. It moves past the irony, the self-destruction, self-destructiveness, the drugs, and some of the artsy pretension of earlier punk rock. And it goes into themes that are more along the lines of truth, reality, seeing things clearly, loyalty, discipline, struggle, standing up for who you are, what you believe in, and this general sense of purpose and forcing meaning into a world where none is given, really. When hardcore first comes out in the early 80s, you see those themes a lot in all the scenes around America. Thing is, New York hardcore was a lot rougher, just as far as where it's coming from sociologically. I mean, these are largely like street kids, poor kids and working class kids. You know, hardcore in DC, I mean, love it. It was a little more middle class. This isn't suburban stuff. The stakes are a little higher, like as far as, you know, the songs about betrayal and like being stabbed in the back. You know, it's not just about someone talking shit about you at school. It's more on the like snitches get stitches kind of side of betrayal. I mean, there's a straight up criminal element in a lot of this music. New York hardcore is also even more exclusively male than other hardcore scenes. fine with me, but it is what it is. The moshing and slam dancing, way bigger in New York and really developed in New York hardcore in a certain way. The sort of the development of distinct dances, the windmill, the picking up change, if you want to call it that. Talking about the customs of New York hardcore and the gradual integration of metal and rap elements over the course of the 80s and 90s. That made New York hardcore very, very distinct by the time we get to the 90s. Okay, let's go back to the very beginning. Attitude. You got some fucking attitude. Pre-New York hardcore is just punk in New York. Not much to really talk about there. You know what the Ramones sound like. You know what the Misfits sound like. They're amazing. They're beautiful. That's punk. And hardcore just was ratcheting that up several notches. One band to mention from pre-New York hardcore in the 70s would be the Stimulators, who definitely were not a hardcore punk band yet, but there's a pivot thing there because Harley Flanagan, who later was in the Cro-Mags, he was playing drums in the Stimulators when he was 10 years old. This is a thing about hardcore, really young kids like doing it for real. So that's a bridge there, the Stimulators. Early New York hardcore, let's say this is from roughly 1980 to 1983. Gotta start off with the Bad Brains. I think of them almost like the Velvet Underground of New York hardcore. You know, people say like, oh, everyone who saw the Velvets, they went right home and started a band immediately. Ironically, they actually were from DC originally, but they moved to New York in 1980 and they put out the single Pay to Come. Brutally fast, hardcore punk, not a million miles away from Minor Threat or something. These guys were an anomaly in other ways, though. First of all, they had like jazz and reggae and fusion chops, which they didn't always use, but that was kind of a presence in their music that a lot of New York hardcore did not have. Also, they were all black. That was unusual. They were also Rastafarians, which while Rastafarianism did not become a thing in New York hardcore, it did lead to other stuff. There's a Hare Krishna thing that happens later in New York hardcore. And just this general thread of like spirituality is a thing in the scene that keeps on going. They also were very big on what they call the PMA, positive mental attitude. That level of positivity, that sort of raging ferocity, but all about being positive, setting goals, achieving, bettering yourself, reaching upward. If you want to see a weird, rare thing, I got a chance to sing a Bad Brain song, Sacred Love, with this house backing band of Mackie from Cro-Mags, Todd Youth from Warzone, and Melvin Gibbs from Rollins Band. Don't ask how that came together, but very special thing. If you want to check that video out, there's a link in the description below. Other bands from that classic early era would be The Mob, Cause for Alarm, and Urban Waste. All right, those bands are all super, super fast. There's not a lot of slow stuff. There's not a lot of metal. There's a sloppiness to it in a good way, right? A looseness, a scrappiness, trying to keep up.
Oh, shit! You seem ignorant! Fuck you! You got no right to judge me! You think I can't think myself? Fuck you! Am I playing yours?
Very lo-fi recordings. People are working with very little resources. So in this time period, this is definitely hardcore punk. It's not hardcore yet. You still would say the word punk with it. A very important record from that time period, from 1982, was a compilation called New York Thrash. It was on the Roir label, R-O-I-R label. It has Bad Brains on it. It actually also has the Beastie Boys on it. A lot of people don't know that they were originally a New York hardcore band before they started rapping. The word thrash in the title might be a little misleading because this isn't thrash music. That word came to mean something else later. Another band I'm going to mention from this time who were not from New York, but were very important to the New York scene, was Negative Approach from Detroit. When they played at CB's, people cite that as being a really big moment for New York hardcore, the influence that they brought, certain toughness, this certain skinhead element. And now we'll talk about what we mean by skinhead because we're not talking about racist skinheads. Underrated from this time period, The Mad. They weren't even really a New York hardcore band, but they were like kind of around that scene and they're on the New York thrash comp. really weird, creepy band.
Fuck your attitude. Fuck your attitude.
So the classic New York hardcore era, let's say this is from 83 to maybe like 88 or so. This is where the street element and the toughness really starts to get foregrounded. Because although a lot of these bands were from Queens, some of these seminal bands were from the Lower East Side, and in general, New York hardcore was happening on the Lower East Side because the sort of mecca of the whole thing was CBGB's. And then there were other venues that didn't last, like A7 is a legendary squat venue, you know, that was way before my time. At that point, it really was like a war zone. I mean, if you look at pictures, and I was a tiny child then, I don't remember, but by the late 80s, I remember walking around New York. And I mean, yeah, it was a violent, insane place with just crack vials under your feet. I mean, really was like that, you know, especially in that neighborhood. And this is the thing, when me and my friends were getting into New York hardcore, like 94, that was like right at the pivot point of New York getting quote unquote cleaned up by Giuliani. Also, we were on the Upper East Side instead of the Lower East Side. So this is, you know, obviously it was like a million times safer. Anyway, yeah, I mean, Giuliani coming in, dude, I know maybe that guy's like a fascist in certain ways, but like, say what you want. I mean, it became way safer. I mean, it's like I stopped getting jacked by the Latin Kings post 94. I mean, it's not a coincidence, you know, so. But, you know, do you want your city to be so safe that it becomes so gentrified that you can't afford to live there? Do you want that? Do you want it to slip back into the crazy war zone? Do we want to romanticize getting stabbed? You know, I don't know. Anyway, the most classic New York hardcore band is Agnostic Front, period. They are, like, I mean, Bad Brains maybe were, like, the godfathers of sparking it off, but Agnostic Front is, like, this is now a thing, hardcore punk in New York. Agnostic Front had some stuff in common with earlier hardcore punk. They did a lot more of the tempo changes. I'm obsessed with these tempo changes because it's really central to, like, whipping the crowd up for dancing. Their classic record is Victim in Pain from 1984. It's a great record, but I actually like their first EP, United Blood, from 83, even better. Because, like, I got into this stuff before, you know, the internet and streaming and all this stuff. It's like I didn't hear United Blood until years later. I just heard about it, but when I was a kid, no one had it because it was like this rare vinyl. It's amazing. Agnostic Front's basically centered around the duo of Vinny Stigma, the guitar player, and Roger Moret, the singer. They're like one of these perfect pairs, man, singer, guitar player, whether it's David Lee Roth and Eddie Van Halen or Robert Plant, Jimmy Page, or Axl and Slash. You know, Roger Moret and Vinny Stigma are one of those iconic duos. He's a really awesome guitar player with his own style. And he's a little older, so he brought some of this classic rock influence in there. Vinny Stigma, I mean, if you watch videos of him, you could watch him for hours. He's like the most New York guy ever to live. Just ball-breaking, hilarious, old-school Italian dude from Little Italy, back when Little Italy was actually an Italian neighborhood. My fear for New York is that in, like, a few years, guys like Vinny Stigma will just be, like, an extinct breed. Like, they'll be, like, a cartoon character, like a, you know, like Yosemite Sam or something. Like, a guy who, like, doesn't exist anymore. I don't want guys like that to die off. For those of you watching this who are into the experimental music world, which a lot of you are because that's me, John Zorn was really influenced by Agnostic Front. He talks about them a lot in the 80s. Seeing them in that time period was a big inspiration for him to start Naked City. Another classic band from this time period, Cro-Mags. Their seminal record, The Age of Quarrel from 1986. This record kind of brought more of a metal element into the situation, and that's big. Some of that chugga-chugga, palm-muting guitar and the tighter riffs, and even some double bass drumming, which is very much a metal thing. Singer John Joseph, legendary frontman, you know, street kid, tough guy, in and out of prison. Harley Flanagan and the bass player and him had all kinds of beef over the years. I guess might have like gotten to the point of like an alleged stabbing in 2012. Not sure what happened there, but they've evolved into these very positive, you know, disciplined martial arts fighters now. So that's a really cool trajectory to see. The title Age of Quarrel is a reference to a Hindu thing, the Kali Yuga. It's the Age of Destruction, and this is important because John Joseph and also Harley Flanagan a little bit became Hare Krishnas. I think at that time they already were, and then they went deeper into it. That spread to other artists and became a little offshoot of hardcore that it's, you could call Krishna-core. Just like the Bad Brains with Rastafarianism, people are searching for something real. They're searching for higher truths. They don't want to be mired in violence and anarchy, and they don't want to be mired in hypocritical, shallow, yuppie 80s culture either. You know, they want some kind of unalienated truth to live under. Really important in this band is the drummer, Mackie Jason. Mackie is one of the sickest drummers, I mean, possibly the sickest drummer in New York hardcore. He brought this that grooving kind of bounce. There's a fusion-y element to it, like coming out of jazz fusion. That groove, that pocket, really alters the course of New York hardcore. Murphy's Law, another very important New York hardcore band. Never really my thing. Their singer, Jimmy Gestapo, I know is like a huge personality that was like really important to the scene. I don't know, their songs were like more about like beer and girls, and like there's a sense of humor to it that probably would have been very refreshing and awesome at the time, but just never really got me that hyped. But you know, all due respect, legendary band. Fourth band I'll mention is Warzone. That's with Rabies, the singer, rest in peace. He died in 1997. I always love them. Lots of chanting, you know, shout along, crew vocals, you know, with the skinhead element, but also metal elements as well. Their record, Don't Forget the Struggle, Don't Forget the Streets, is classic. Let me go through the weather. Inside myself, I can hear the screams. Warzone was very much a skinhead band, and so was Agnostic Front. And let's talk a little bit about the politics. We don't have to go too deep into it, but it's important that, you know, these bands got accused of being Nazi skinheads, and they absolutely were not. They would make it clear in songs, you know, we want brotherhood, black and white, unity, none of this Nazi stuff. And, you know, if neo-Nazis came around shows, I mean, apparently, you know, people would beat them up really badly. I mean, there's a lot of like, you know, cracking down on Nazis coming by. But, you know, also at the same time, a lot of those same bands would have songs that were very conservative in their politics. I mean, some of these bands were into Reagan and, you know, Agnostic Front and Warzone. You know, they'll have songs about really criticizing welfare system and welfare recipients. And even some anti-immigration stuff that could be considered racist. I mean, that's from more bands like Antidote and Youth Defense League and stuff. And a lot of people just being super patriotic, which is not a bad thing. So there's, in a way, it's like there is some confusion or variation or heterogeneous, you know, political elements that don't add up to like one coherent ideology, which is probably one of the reasons why I like New York hardcore, because it's not like this one ideology like beating you over the head. Underrated from this period, Antidote. People who love New York hardcore obviously completely know them very well, but outside of New York hardcore, you know, people don't talk about them that much. I've seen enough of this world to know what's good and bad. Late 80s, early 90s, let's call that the next phase. This is the phase where the metal elements really get absorbed. Like after Age of Quarrel, it starts to sink in with a bunch of new bands that really have some like Metallica elements. But also in 86, there's the Agnostic Front record Cause for Alarm. That's credited with upping the metal ante a lot as well. great band from this time is Killing Time. Always loved Killing Time. First, they were called Raw Deal, and they became Killing Time. That record, Bright Side, is so sick.
Wisdom in chains, unlocked, too late.
A lot of the riffing is kind of like Metallica, but the whole vibe of the stuff is like pure hardcore. I like the bands that are like tough, but they're not so tough that it's just nothing that I could possibly relate to, you know? So it's like they're not singing about, like, you know, life on the streets, hitting someone in the face with a brick, you know? It's not that kind of vibe, but it's like standing on the subway and just being kind of fed up and just like, you know, it's like, you're not like a thug, but you're just like, bro, like, you're like standing too close to me. Like, you need to back the fuck up. Like, you know, it's like that kind of that kind of New York energy. Like, that I can really get into. How amazing is that album cover too? I love it when something just nails something. You know, that cover nails the vibe. Another great band, Leeway. They get so metallic that you could almost call them crossover thrash. Metal with hardcore elements rather than hardcore with metal elements. Certain way we're splitting hairs. Anyway, Leeway, awesome. Sheer Terror is big from this time. They were metallic, but they were kind of nastier and grimier, a little more lo-fi, less technical. Never a huge band for me, but really important, and I liked them. A really important compilation record from this time was called Where the Wild Things Are from 1989. It was on Blackout Records. That has a bunch of these bands on it. Seminal. Sick of It All. Big band from this time. We already talked about them. Check out Carnivore. That was a band that was Pete Steele, who went on to do Typo Negative and become very famous for that. A lot of really tongue-in-cheek edgelord humor, songs like Jesus Hitler. Good stuff. They're from Brooklyn too, which was that was kind of important because so many of these hardcore bands have been from Queens and then some from the Lower East Side. Carnivore kind of put Brooklyn on the map, I think. Underrated from this time period, Dark Side NYC. Interesting band because they were bringing some metal elements where it wasn't so much the thrash elements as much as there was actually kind of a black metal flavor in there, which is rare for hardcore. Before we go deeper into the 90s, quick detour, 1989, I think it is, ABC No Rio opens. This is a new venue that apparently it was kind of an alternative to CB's in a certain way. I played there a couple times. It's more of like the kind of art space where they have like the pamphlets for the political stuff and it's like food not bombs and it's like sort of explicitly lefty kind of space. I think a more inclusive place for women and, you know, LGBTQ people. But, you know, this is not to say that, like, CB's, like, you get gay bash going in there. It's not, you know, it's not like that. But things were, I guess, getting more and more violent at CB's, just in general. Not even politically, but just, you know, just the pits, I guess, were getting so brutal that ABC No Rio is kind of a place where there's, like, different bands that kind of overlap with the other scene, but like slightly different bands made that their home, I think. And two of them that people talk about is Born Against and Rorschach. Born Against are awesome. I didn't really know about them super well when I was younger. Got into them kind of later. Cool, they're political. One interesting thing to check out, there was this beef between Sick of It All and Born Against. Search for that on YouTube. They have this kind of like argument on the NYU radio. Lou Collar from Sick of It All has this quote, this isn't ABC No Rio, this is hardcore. I don't know exactly what he means by that, but if you check out that beef, many of the issues of the day in the late 80s, early 90s will come into relief. Rorschach is my shit, dude. Passionate flames, moving, passionate states, worse as we fear. Darkness clutches the eyes, I see a soul. They're bringing tough hardcore vibes in with metal elements that are actually more experimental, for lack of a better word, dissonant, angular, proggy type stuff a little bit. They hit this sweet spot that for me spun me out into checking out way more out there kind of post-hardcore related stuff. There's also Nausea, who are kind of a more of a crust hardcore band that were definitely made ABC No Rio their home. Again, before we go deeper into the 90s, late 80s, there's a really important sub-genre that people would call youth crew hardcore or just straight edge New York hardcore. All these bands are straight edge. That's a big part of it. 1988 is definitely the main year for this. Two main bands are Youth of Today and Gorilla Biscuits. First of all, the fashion sense is very distinctive. Instead of some like skinhead looking vibes, or instead of the sort of apocalyptic Mad Max looking road warrior shit that people had in the 80s, these kids went into this like clean cut kind of dressing like jocks from an 80s movie, this sort of wholesome clean cut look to kind of go with the straight edge thing. There's also a big thing about writing the X on the back of your hand. When you'd go to an all ages show but you're underage, the door person would put an X on your hand so that you couldn't drink, to show that you couldn't drink at the bar. So these kids that were committed to being straight edge would put the X's on themselves. The vibe of this whole thing is, you know, it's definitely not street shit, it's definitely not criminal enterprise, but it's tough in the sense of discipline, you know, and it does feed into that vibe with the Rastafarianism and the Hare Krishna of higher values, discipline, living under something, you know? I have a lot of respect for these bands, but it's just not really my thing. My friends were really into it.
Let's start today. Let's start today.
The way that it's melodic and upbeat and motivational just didn't really resonate. But, you know, one reason why Gorilla Biscuits were really important to me and my friends anyway was that the guy from them, Walter Schreifels, he went on to front the band Quicksand. And Quicksand I loved. And they're kind of like post-hardcore, which we'll talk about like in the 90s. But so, like, Walter Schreifels was kind of like the cool kid in town that we all, like, some people that kind of knew him and, like, you know, we wanted to hang out if we could with him. And it's like, ooh, what did Walter do? Walter this? You know, it was like kind of like he was like that, like, older cool kid. He ended up, like, dating a friend of mine after high school. It wasn't shady or anything. Youth of Today was a little bit harder edge than Gorilla Biscuits sonically. They're important largely because Ray Capo from Youth of Today went on to found Revelation Records, a very important hardcore label in the late 80s and 90s and beyond. They had a seminal compilation they put out in 1988 called New York City Hardcore, The Way It Is. The straight edge band that I did like is Judge. Judge was just a little more negative. They've got one of the most brutal straight edge lyrics I've ever heard. That's less like the motivational speaker kind of straight edge and more just like menacing. My friends love this, but none of us were straight edge at all. In fact, the first time I heard any of these bands, my friends were playing it while getting completely wasted drinking 40s with like fake ironic X's on our hands. Like, you know, that we thought that was funny. Tiny offshoot in the early 90s, Krishna-core, I mentioned it. Ray Capo, the guy who founded Revelation from Youth of Today, he went on to found the band Shelter. Really interesting, not in the typical mold of metallic New York hardcore at all. They have interesting emo-ish kind of guitar stuff that's kind of off-kilter and more emotional sounding. 108 is another Krishna-core band.
Gotta do what I gotta do for the crew. Down by law.
Mid to late 90s. So now we're getting into this era that you could call it like beatdown hardcore or tough guy hardcore. I just thought of it as hardcore. But this is the point where it's like no one is saying hardcore punk anymore. Like the word punk had been kind of gradually erased over the time with the more metal elements happening. And now you get these bands in the 90s that don't even listen to punk. So the first band from this era that I heard was Biohazard. They're definitely the biggest New York hardcore band probably ever, just as far as like they were on MTV like a bunch. You know, they were on the radio. Their record Urban Discipline from 1992 is just undeniable. These guys were from Brooklyn, so it was another Brooklyn act after Carnivore. The sort of influence that Mackie brought in the Cro-Mags, the drummer, that bounce, that groove, that sort of funk, almost rap-influenced thing gets to another level with Biohazard. And also Biohazard are like actually doing kind of rap vocals. All due respect to a legendary band, I used to laugh really hard at this line.
In reality, we all face the facts that a majority of the people out smoke crack.
Like, the majority of people are smoking crack? I mean, that's gotta be overstating the case, right? Biohazard also very important because I really think that for better or worse, they paved the way for nu metal. You know, the rap and hardcore and punk combination. I don't know if Biohazard like nu metal or if they would feel good about having helped spawn it, but you know, you can't control who your children are. Another great tough band from then is Marauder, also from Brooklyn, I think. Their metal element is almost like on a death metal thing. My absolute favorite from this mid-90s quote-unquote tough guy hardcore time period is Madball. Just classic, just absolutely classic New York music. Forget about hardcore, just music from the city. Madball.
As the night got deeper, we'll go that fight. And you know the price you'll pay, that price with the night.
Freddie Madball is just a legendary singer. He's the half-brother of Roger Moret from Agnostic Front. And I love this kind of lore, man. The lore, the history, the family that Roger would bring him on tour when he was 7 years old. And he would bring Freddie on stage to sing songs. There's like footage of this, of him screaming Agnostic Front songs. So he grew up in this. Madball's drummer, Will Shepler. It's in that tradition of like having fusion elements, real chops. Dudes who listen to like Steve Gadd and fusion and like Tony Williams and stuff. Like I was saying, if you compare like the metalcore vibe of Madball, if you compare that to like Earth Crisis from upstate who are doing the same kind of thing at the same time, it's kind of not the same kind of thing.
Violence against violence, let the roundups begin.
That Earth Crisis chugga chugga metalcore stuff, it's brutal, but it's like square. It's stiff. It's like militaristic. It's militant, you know? It's not sexy, you know? Earth Crisis is like joyless brutality. Madball fucks. Like, Madball is like, there's like groove. Classic record is Set It Off from 1994, but any of that early stuff is great. Another great one from this time period, Crown of Thorns. They're known as being the super tough beatdown band, largely because their singer, Danny Diablo, aka Lord Ezek, has a big reputation for being a fighter and violent and stuff. You know, he had some lore surrounding him. But Crown of Thorns is actually kind of, they had almost emo-ish elements on the guitar though, guitar and bass work. Ezek is basically an international hardcore superstar, amazing guy, super interesting. And as I said before, I was honored to have him on the Last Things live stream. The link to that is in the description below. Underrated from this time period, Neglect from Long Island. Scary band. Don't hear about them a lot anymore. Another phase I'm going to define is 90s New York post-hardcore. Biggest band of this would be Quicksand, like I mentioned before. Walter Schreifels from Gorilla Biscuits. Super different than Gorilla Biscuits and really super different from hardcore in general.
It's beginning. Mother's code is simple.
There's a certain lurching kind of swinging rhythm to it that kind of does come out of Mackie and Sick of It All in these bands. The vocals are a lot more like emo-esque. They were on the radio a bunch. There's also Orange 9mm, not as amazing as Quicksand, but also great. They almost had more of like a nu metal vibe like before that was a thing. Kind of an underrated pocket within this underrated scene was bands like Bad Trip and Mind Over Matter. These bands, like, they're not emo, but they get into this sort of more interesting guitar playing. It's not just like low power chords and stuff. There's more like, you know, arpeggios and like little details and stuff, weird harmonies. The most underrated and totally sick band of this New York post-hardcore thing is Hell No. I I never hear people talk about Hell No anymore. They're just bizarre. Like, if you're into, like, Rorschach and like, that thing where this metallic hardcore stuff just goes off the deep end with, like, really dissonant, like, math rock type stuff, but with the nasty New York hardcore element, Hell No is it, man.
I take a look in your eyes. I don't like what I see. You live your life as a fake, and I'm as real as can be.
New York hardcore in the 2000s, here's where I lose the thread a little bit, just because I wasn't listening to it at the time. Important band from the 2000s is definitely Glassjaw.
Turns into a photo the size of my fist, I hope she knows.
They were Long Island, and Long Island kind of had a thing happening in the 2000s. Glassjaw really are the pivot point. They pivot towards emo and screamo. Glassjaw, I would not describe as a cheesy band, but their melodic singing parts really get into the territory of, like, cheeseball 2000s mall emo. You can blame Glassjaw for that stuff. But Glassjaw are cool. They, because they also actually have some, like, proggy, you know, interesting wacky guitar shit that almost gets into some, like, At the Drive-In. Other bands from Long Island, you got Silent Majority. Kill Your Idols are great. That's my boy Paul. They almost had more bringing back almost like a more old school element with just, like, the fast hardcore, but they're very much in that scene, toured a lot, got a lot of respect. A couple of really metallic bands from this time are Sworn Enemy and Full Blown Chaos. These bands are cool. They're not really bringing much new to the table exactly. It's tough, though. It's brutal. Sworn Enemy are cool. There's a venue in Brooklyn in Bushwick in the 2000s called 538 Johnson. It was this kind of like warehousey kind of place where they'd have a lot of hardcore shows and punk and other stuff. I went there several times, but not for hardcore stuff, more noise rock stuff. And that was very much a scene. I'm really not familiar with any of the bands that were really in that scene. I'll tell you, a great band from the 2000s that were considered hardcore and aren't, you know, socially in the lineage of New York hardcore is a Drunk Driver, who were friends of mine. Drunk Driver ripped.
I'm in the city and I'm ready to fight. Ready to fight.
2010s. There's a band, Warthog, they're a little bit more like D-beat and crusty and nasty. You know, they're not like totally my kind of thing, but they're very good. Two bands that are awesome are Incendiary and King Nine. There's a lot of music in the 10s that is not from New York, but is not hardcore, but is really influenced by New York hardcore. And I love seeing that, seeing the influence of New York hardcore spread far out of its own geographical and stylistic bounds. I mean, bands like Youth Code, Death Grips, that band Horror, Girl Pusher is another one. These bands, they all owe something to New York hardcore. This young producer, his name is Jared, but he goes by Kala Beats. He makes this noise, rap, punk, hardcore fusion. I don't even know what to call it. And these Zoomers, a lot of them have absorbed New York hardcore and are processing it in ways that are just genre-wise totally different, but you feel the elements. But look, if we're talking about New York hardcore in the 2010s, show me the body are my shit. Man, that's actually some of my favorite music happening right now. I don't care. Like, I'll just stand for this shit, dude. I don't care.
Get the face down, deaf into silence. Finding some blinded by the law of violence. Sun has a night, scared of the shining. Get a boy, scared of shame.
They're musically so rooted in, like, Warzone, Madball, the whole tradition. The guy plays a banjo, though. But it's like distorted electric banjo, so it sounds just like this trebly, nasty, biting guitar sound. It also has absorbed all the, you know, history of, like, noise and experimental no-wave type stuff and post-punk, because it's got this gloom to it, along with the bounce and the groove and the mosh parts. I kept talking about tempo changes being a driving force behind the pit. With Show Me the Body, it's like they'll build songs up from absolutely nothing. I mean, they'll have songs where it'll be like 2 minutes in the drums and bass kick in, and the beginning is just like quiet and just menacing creepiness.
You can see it in the dead of night, cuffed up, none of them white. One of them flinched and the cops got tied.
Cut your gloves, they told them what's up.
Amazing vocalist, brutal lyrics, really tough but like poetic and kind of elegant. There's this thoughtfulness to it. And them going off on gentrification in New York is just like, it really gives me goosebumps.
They don't belong here!
They have this collective called Corpus that has all these other acts affiliated with it, like Dream Crusher, Dog Breath, Cold Deck. There's a few other, President Evil. It overlaps with like noise and rap, very much a graffiti thing, I think. Definitely a skating and graffiti kind of culture. I also just, I love those dudes because it's just like, it's Jewish kids from Manhattan, but like the whole scene is like, you know, Queens and Brooklyn, like Puerto Rican kids. I mean, it's one of the most diverse, ethnically diverse scenes and class diverse scenes I've seen in a while, which is what New York hardcore always is and was. Not that I'm tallying up diversity quotas, you know, I'm like the last guy to like morally give a fuck about that, but it's like, but culture, I mean, that's, it's a beautiful thing, man. So I just took you from Bad Brains to Show Me the Body. It's like 40 years of music. It's one of the most beautiful things ever to happen on planet Earth, New York hardcore. What's the future of New York hardcore? Look, man, I'm not the guy to say, I'm not even the guy to hazard a guess. Look, I think New York is always going to have deep music happening. I hope. But look, I mean, music and art, it's always a product of its environment. You know what I mean? And I don't want to romanticize crime and poverty, but some great music came out of it. Right now, New York is slipping back into brutal crime. It's like out of control. And yet the rent is still sky high and not going down. So it's like the worst of both worlds. So I don't know what's going to happen. I mean, is it basically just going to be that things get more brutal but still get more and more gentrified, and it's like the entire landscape just becomes these like glass condos where like oil chic sons like store their like motorcycles and shit, and they're only there like a couple days a year, and then other than that it's just people getting slashed in the face with box cutters, but they're like not leaving because they still want to live in New York so bad. Like, what kind of music is that gonna breed? I'm not sure. I'm about to move back next year, so we will see. Whatever it is, I'm gonna be just loving it, because I can't, LA, dude, you can't comprehend how whack LA is, man. I can't really make you understand. In the meantime, before I see you, what am I going to say? Am I really going to say keep it real at the end of this? Am I actually going to take it there and say keep it real? I mean, maybe. You might want to keep it real. Larry David voice. I'm just saying. All right. See you then.